Thank you, Dr. Hanan, for your illuminating, interesting lecture. And thank you again for being strict to time. Now we are shifting to the last lecture in our webinar today, coming from Dr. Sondus Magdi, the lecturer of pediatric critical care in Shams University, about weaning from mechanical ventilation.
Okay. Thanks, Dr. Merve, for introducing me. I'm sorry I cannot share my my video because I have troubles like Dr. Hanan in internet connection. Today, after we learned from Dr. Ahmed Raz the basics of mechanical ventilation, and from Dr. Hanan how to put different diseases on the suitable settings for each patient, and from Dr. Marty how to troubleshoot any patient and the cases he discussed with us today. آخر حاجة بقى هنعملها weaning from mechanical ventilation. Okay, deal guidelines. This is the guidelines that is the presentation adapted from. If we read the titled guidelines, we'll see it is the weaning from mechanical ventilation. This is an adult task force from European Respiratory Society and American Thoracic Society in 2007. It's upgraded in 2016, and there's another guideline in 2018. All of these guidelines is for adult ventilation, adult weaning from mechanical ventilation. But unfortunately, in pediatrics, there is not in this hard way to match suitable guidelines. ودي كان اخر ريكومنديشن للبيدياتريك ميكانيكال فنتيليشن كونسنسس كونفرنس. قالوا لنا they said that there is no sufficient data to recommend when to initiate what is the protocol of weaning of pediatric patients, but they suggest that early weaning is beneficial and to use non-invasive ventilation. Okay. This schema is from the Task Force for Weaning from Mechanical Ventilation 2007. It represents the different stages that occur in any mechanically ventilated patient from admission till discharge. The first stage is treatment of the cause of acute respiratory failure. أنت بتعالج هنا عيانك why he is ventilated. If it is pneumonia or asthma or ARDS or sepsis, you should treat the cause of respiratory failure which necessitating mechanical ventilation. Okay. The second stage is suspicious. It means any clinician or intensivist should suspect when this patient is ready to wean. And how the third stage is to assess the readiness of weaning. Fourth stage is to do spontaneous breathing trial to try to wean your patient. Then after successful spontaneous breathing trial, you can extubate him. After extubation, you have to pathways, either in the extubation will be successful, so our patient will be discharged from our PQ, or who will be reintubated again. Okay, here is some definitions we need to know. Okay, هو في مشكلة؟ في مشكلة في الصوت؟
No, it's okay, Dr. Sondus.
أصلاً مش شايفة دكتور الكويستشنز وخايفة يحصل زي ما حصل قبل كده في كذا مرة معايا فأنا مش عارف. Okay, here is some definitions. Okay, ثانية خلاص أشيل الكويستشنز. Okay. What does it mean by weaning? يعني إيه weaning? Weaning is means that gradual reduction in level of respiratory support after weaning. After you reduce the level of your respiratory support, you will have three fates. Either your weaning will be successful, and this means that extubation with absence of any ventilatory support during first full 48 hours after the extubation, or your patient will need support by non-invasive ventilation, and this will be called weaning in progress, or your patient needs re-intubation again, and this is called weaning failure. But weaning failure has another can be defined by one of the following: either failed spontaneous breathing trial, or reintubation or resumption of ventilative support بعد 72 ساعة after extubation, or any death of your patient بعد الشهر during first 48 hours after extubation. Okay. Why we need to wean our patient? وليه إحنا بندور على weaning وليه كل guidelines are saying to early assessment for your patient for early weaning. Why we need to wean our patient? Why not to keep him on mechanical ventilator? Because mechanical ventilation will be harmful our patient. It will harm from the vocal cords up to down to deep to the lung. in vocal cords, it can cause vocal cord granuloma. It can cause ulceration of the vocal folds. It may cause subglottic stenosis and airway edema. It may cause epithelial damage of the trachea and loss of ciliary function and impairment tracheal mucus clearance. Also, it is a very hazardous, he will be very liable to sepsis and ventilator-associated pneumonia. Also, it can preclude oral feeding and may induce ventilator-induced lung injury, and we will develop ARDS from the ventilator itself. So early weaning, early assessment of weaning and readiness for weaning is beneficial and advisable for all clinicians. Again, here, after we treat the cause of acute respiratory failure, we should suspect that our patient is ready to wean. How can we suspect this? By clinical assessment and objective measures. Clinical assessment is they, if your patient has adequate cough, if your patient has absence of excessive tracheobronchial secretion, which be good secretion criteria for tashfit, you don't need to do frequent suction for him. He's not have excessive secretion or vessel secretion. And also he must be, you must treat the acute phase of the disease. He has pneumonia, you are giving him antibiotics and he is improving if he has asthma. So there is resolution of the bronchospasm. If he has a central cause of respiratory depression like medication or poisoning or intracranial hemorrhage, this should be treated or controlled at least. This is about clinical assessment. So your patient must have adequate cough, must have low bronchial secretion, and there is a resolution of the acute phase of the disease. What is the objective measures that I can look for in my patient to suspect that he is ready for weaning? He must have stable cardiovascular status, stable heart rate, stable blood pressure, also stable metabolic status, and we'll discuss it later. Also, adequate oxygenation. He must be saturated above 90 on FI to 40%.
Valuable, please slow down.
Okay. Okay. LB must be below 8, but this is a guideline for task force for adult, not for us. BIP 8 in pediatric, it is it's considered high for a pediatric patient. We cannot wean on BIP 8. We must reduce it first. He must have adequate pulmonary function, adequate respiratory rate below, with a normal for his physiological range of respiratory rate. Maximum BIP must be below 20 if he is on tidal volume ventilation. Tidal volume, spontaneous tidal volume must be above 5 ml per kg. RSPI, our rapid sequence breathing, and we'll talk about it later. He must have no significant respiratory acidosis in the ABG. And of course, he must be aware, he must be, there's adequate mentation, and he's not disturbed or on deep sedation. Okay. What is the weaning criteria we should discuss? We should look for in pediatric patient. This is adopted from multiple guidelines and task forces. Ventilatory criteria, BCO2 must be below 50, pH in a normal above 7.35. Spontaneous respiratory rate بتاعه below 30. Spontaneous tidal volume from 5 to 8 ml per kg. Oxygenation criteria, BO2 be above 100 at FI to 40%. يعني ما يكونش العيانة FI to 100% وقول BO2 بتاعه أكتر من 100, I wean him. لا, reduce the FI to الأول and monitor BO2 على FI to بتاعه. بس طبعا بيبقى arterial BO2 مش venous.
Dr. Sundus, I can't hear you. Can you raise your voice?
Okay, doctor.
Please. Yes.
Okay, doctor. Saturation must be above 90 at FI to 40%. BF ratio should be above 200. And it'll be below 5, and this is in pediatric. Pulmonary measurement, the maximum PIP must be below 20. Static compliance, but this is for adult. And rapid shower breathing index, we will discuss it later. Other factors that we should monitor during weaning, like metabolic factor, we must assess the nutrition status of our patient. We must give him adequate nutrition, because inadequate nutrition will cause protein catabolism and will affect the muscular function of the diaphragm and intercostal muscles. If our baby is wasted, he cannot maintain or sustain his normal spontaneous breathing. Also, overfeeding can increase the CO2 production and cause respiratory acidosis and increase the work of breathing. So we must give him adequate nutrition and to avoid overfeeding. Also, we must monitor الفوسفورس ليفل, ماجنيسيوم ليفل اند بوتاسيوم ليفل, كوز هايبوفوسفاتيميا والكوز رابدوميالسيس اند ماسل ويكنس, هايبوماجنيزيميا والكوز ماسل ويكنس, هايبوكاليميا والانديوس ايليس اند باراليسيس اند ماسل. So all of this electrolytes should be in the normal level before weaning our patient, deciding to wean our patient. Also renal factor, our patient must be having adequate urine output because oliguria will cause pulmonary edema and volume overload and will impair pulmonary mechanics of the lung. Cardiovascular function, you should maintain your patient with normal cardiac output within normal heart rate and the blood pressure parameter to ensure that your patient have adequate oxygenation or ventilation to the tissue. Also CNS assessment, our patient must be conscious and alert and can sustain his airway and can has adequate cough and he can maintain normal respiratory rate and normal respiratory drive. Okay, what is rapid shallow breathing index? The index was advised by Young and Tobin et al. 1991, that can mainly for adult, and they assumed if you put your patient on a spontaneous mode and is ready for weaning. So your patient will take, if he is ready for weaning and you put him in a spontaneous mode like pressure support ventilation, he will respire. He will take respiratory rate with a normal range, and he will have a good tidal volume in each breath. But if he cannot tolerate spontaneous breathing, he will be tachypneic with high respiratory rate and will breathe shallowly with low tidal volume. So if you have a, لو احنا قسمنا respiratory rate over the high respiratory rate over low tidal volume, you will have a high index. So higher index means that your patient is not suitable for weaning. This is the equation, how can we calculate RSPI? We calculate respiratory rate in spontaneous mode over tidal volume, and we can express it in breath per minute per liter. So tidal volume will be a liter, not in milliliter, like it appear in parameters on the ventilator. So in RSPI in adults below 105, it means that we have successful spontaneous breathing trial. If it is above 105, this means that your patient is not suitable for weaning and he needs to be put again on mandatory modes. So, عشان بس نفهمها كويس, there is an example here. If you're an adult patient with respiratory rate 20, which is more or less normal for his normal for adult, and tidal volume for each breath 250 ml. If we, لو احنا قسمناه على بعض, we can 20 over 0.25 because the index is in liter, not in milliliter. So 20 over 0.25 will be equal 80 breath per minute per liter, which is below 105. So our patient is ready for weaning. Like in, if we have an adult patient, another patient, you put him in spontaneous mode, he will take a respiratory rate of 40, which is more, of course it is tachypnea, and tidal volume in each breath equal 100 ml. So 40 over 0.1 will equal 400 breaths per minute per liter, which is mean above 105. So your patient is not ready for weaning. يبقى RSPI ده معناه ايه؟ معناه ان انت بتقسس العينك على على spontaneous mode. لو انت حطيته على spontaneous mode ولقيت الولد او لقيت الادلت taking a high respiratory rate and low tidal volume in each breath, this means that your patient is tachypneic and breathing shallowly, so your patient is not ready for weaning. لكن لو عينك is taking a normal respiratory rate with good tidal volume, this means that the index will be low and your patient is ready for weaning. لو احنا خلنا ال RSPI اللي هو ال RSPI index دوت وعملنا له apply على ال pediatric patients بتوعنا. لو انت عندك عيان, you have a patient, the weight بتاعه 10 kilograms, ولما حطيته على spontaneous mode, he's taking 30 breaths per minute. وتايدل volume of each breath is 80 ml. طب لو احنا اتكلمنا بقى على البيشنت around 1 year, يعني 10 kilograms equal around, البيبي will be around 1 year, 1 year old, is taking 30 breaths per minute, and this is of course with a normal range for his age, and the tidal volume 80 ml per 80 ml, so it will be 8 ml per kg, so it's more than enough for his age. So our this patient, without calculating this index, is ready for weaning. Of course, he is ready for weaning because he is with optimum parameters. لكن لو جينا هنحسب الindex يبقى 30 over 0.08 because we calculate the index again in liter not in milliliter. It will equal 375 which is above 105. So your patient is not ready for weaning by this equation. So RSPI is not applicable in children. في studies كتيرة اتعملت وعشان يعملوا calibration of this index in pediatrics وكذا study اتعملت وطلعوا منها موديفيكيشن وقالوا ان احنا هنعمل موديفيكيشن ازاي ان احنا نخلي ريسبيراتوري فريكوانسي اوفر التايدال فوليوم مل بير كي جي عشان تبقى اكسبريست ان باث بير مينيت بير مل بير كي جي. لو احنا خدنا عيالنا اللي فوق ده تاني خدنا 30 اوفر 8 مل بير كي جي والبي 3.75 باث بير مينيت بالمر بير كي جي وحطوا لها هنا نورمال فاليو بتاعتها. في ستاديز سيد ستات بيلو 8 وستاديز تانية قالت هي بيلو 11 بس عموما 3.75 اقل من 8 واقل من 11 so your patient is ready for weaning. Okay, how to wean your patient بقى زي بنعمل weaning كلنا لما بيجي نحب نعمل weaning لعيان if you ask it any one of your juniors how to wean your patient هيقول لك you can reduce the level of ventilatory support هنقلله نقلل PIP to reduce the PIP to reduce the PIP to reduce the pressure support to reduce the respiratory rate. This is one of the model for weaning methods. Other meaning method is to try spontaneous breathing trial, or we can simply wean your patient if he is not he's ventilated for short time like post-surgical patient, أي عيان post-surgery اللي هو مش extubated during recovery from anesthesia. He can be weaned very rapidly with no need of this weaning method or spontaneous breathing trial. Usually you can give him ADEX and you remove the tube. If the trying spontaneous breathing trial for 30 to 120 minutes, then you can extubate him. No need for decrease weaning weaning and ventilatory and decrease the ventilatory support. Or, زي ما بيحصل عندنا كلنا, like it occurs in all of our ICUs, accidental weaning. The incidence بتاعته مش قليلة. It's not very low incidence. In 0.316%. 83% منها self extubation العيانة كراح شدد الأنبوبة ويحصل كتير و 17% 17% other causes like in during nursing during taking shower of the patient he can ease the tube ما إيه can be slipped could be slipped. Okay طيب how to reduce the level of ventilatory support like we said to decrease the PIP pressure support respiratory rate وال SIMV ممكن احنا معظمنا all of us يعني تقريبا كلنا مستخدم SIMV with pressure support. ده مود زي ما اتفقنا زي دكتور احمد قال like دكتور احمد سيد that we they had a mandatory breath and mandatory rate and assisted or supported rate so you can wean by decreasing the machine rate اللي هو ايه mandatory breath. Okay what is a spontaneous breathing trial? It includes that hot العين. You are putting your patient on spontaneous mode. Spontaneous mode using TPs or CPAP or pressure support ventilation. TPs ديت زي ما موجود في الصورة like in the picture connected endotracheal tube to TPs and then to a connected to oxygen source oxygen outside and oxygen source not from the ventilator. Or trying to use CPAP or trying to use a pressure support ventilation mode. Automatic tube compensation. This is a يعني ده مود option في ال ventilators. بيبقى to compensate for that resistance of endotracheal tube. طيب, okay. How to do spontaneous breathing trial by pressure support ventilation? The most common mode or method of weaning. You put your patient and be below 5. Pressure support below 10 in pediatrics or below 5 or 8 in adults. وزي ما اتفقنا as we aim like Dr. Hanan said, that the endotracheal tube, or Dr. Ahmed Rizzi said, that the endotracheal tube, كل ما نقل في السايز بتاعها, يعني مثلا 3-3.5, it will have a higher resistance. So when decreasing the radius of endotracheal tube, it will increase resistance. So you will have, you must put your patient on a higher pressure support. So the smaller the tube, you will need a higher pressure support to overcome the resistance of endotracheal tube. يعني 80 tube sized 3 to 3.5, minimum pressure support level will be 10, 4 to 4.5 it be 8. Above 5, you can put pressure support as low as 6 centimeter water. Pressure support is will overcome the resistance of the ventilatory circuit and the endotracheal tube. بعد كده you can try spontaneous breathing for put him on pressure support ventilation and we'll monitor your patient for 30 minutes and if he's tolerating and there is no distress or no and or desaturation or the tachycardia or hypotension or diaphoresis, and the patient's comfort, you can extend your spontaneous breathing trial up to 2 hours, yani 120 minutes. What should I monitor during spontaneous breathing trial to assess if it is failed or it is successful trial? As we aimed, دايما كل مرة بيقولوها في ال consensus, they have a clinical assessment and objective measurement. Clinical assessment زي إيه؟ You should assess your patient if he put him on a spontaneous mood and he become agitated and anxiety. إحنا عيننا في العين الكبار بيردوا علينا. يعني إيه لو في يعني تقريبا الأدولاسنس أو 10 years أو 9 years كده, he can tell you if he is comfortable or not. ساعتين نسألهم أنت مستريح, المدة مريحك, حابب أغير لك, يعني نسألهم وساعات بيردوا علينا. If he is a small baby, you can monitor for agitation and anxiety, sweating, decreased mental status because of hypercapnia. If the patient will become cyanosed or have a respiratory distress like working LMSI, intercostal subcostal retractions, or facial signs of distress, your patient looks ill and ill and cannot take his breath, so you should end your trial and put him again on a mandatory rate. Now, what is the objective measurement? You should measure your PO2 if it decreased to below 50 or saturation below 90, or if I do above 50%. لو البي سي اي 2 بتاعنا عالي above 50 مليمتر مركري, البي اتش بتاعتنا بقى فيه اسيدوزس, ار اس بي اي بتاعنا بقى هيبقى مش ده الرقم بتاع الادلت, هيبقى below 8 or 11 breath per minute بالمير بير كي جي. لو الريت بتاعنا عالي عن النورمال فيسيولوجيكال ريت بتاع العيان, يعني لو بقى above 50 لو هو من 0 ل 3 او above 40 لو هو من 3 to 8 years or above 30 لو هو above 8 years of age. لو حسبنا spontaneous tidal volume during spontaneous pressure support mode, لو لقيناها below 4 mL per kg, so your patients cannot sustain normal tidal volume, so this trial is failed. لو heart rate بقى tachypneic or tachycardic, sorry, or hypotensive or hypertensive, or he developed arrhythmia, so this trial is failed. Okay. هنا ده consensus وزفنا ده في الأدلت. هو قال هنا إن هو as early as possible, وان هم مش بيحبوا زي نوت دو نوت يعني سبوتينز بريدنج ترايل. هو ده الميجر دايجنوستيك تيست, وده اللي احنا كان ديتكت هو كان بي سكسسفلي وين اند هو كان هاف ويننج فيلير, وان هم زي دونت لايك الاس ام ام في از ا مود اوف ويننج. طيب اوكي, we can classify our patient according to weaning result into simple weaning. This means that your patient will have a successful weaning after first attempt of extubation. يعني شلت الأنبوبة وعينك بقى كويس, ما فيهوش أي حاجة خالص. So your patient has simple weaning. If your patient failed initial weaning, so he required up to 3 spontaneous breathing trial or at least 1 week from the initiation first spontaneous breathing trial, so he had a difficult weaning. If he prolonged weaning, this means that your patient محتاج أكتر من 3 spontaneous breathing trial, or he needs more than 7 days after initial spontaneous breathing trial to be weaned. يعني إيه؟ يعني أنت لو عينك you tried أن أنت تعمل له spontaneous breathing trial and he successed this spontaneous breathing trial and you extubated him. If you have a successful extubation and your patient can maintain his spontaneous breathing, so this is simple weaning. But if you cannot wean him after initial spontaneous breathing trial, or he failed up to 3 spontaneous breathing trial, or you need more than 1 week to do spontaneous breathing trial, this means difficult weaning. So less than 7 days, more than 7 days, or you need more than 3 spontaneous breathing trials, prolonged weaning, and you should search for the cause why your patient has difficult or prolonged weaning. Okay, but إيه هي common pathologies اللي ممكن تخليه عيننا can lead to prolonged or difficult weaning. You should search for this is multifactorial causes, respiratory, cardiac, neuromuscular, metabolic, renal. You should assess your patient because of ventilation and lung function depend on the function of the whole body. يعني respiratory load, you should assess if your patient have increased work of breathing on ventilator. يعني if the ventilator is auto-triggering, so he has a high respiratory rate on the ventilator. this will cause like auto triggering the water in the circuit, or you have a small low level of trigger. So the patient will on the mechanical ventilation taking like 50 to 60 breaths per minute for 2 or 3 days. So this isn't too much rate for him. This will cause muscle exhaustion and will cause muscle weakness. And you should treat this cause, and you should be sure that your patient is not taking on the ventilator. Also, the diseases that reduce the compliance, like if your patient develops VAB, ventilator acquired pneumonia, or he has a cardiogenic disease and is not controlled, or he develops non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema from sepsis, or he has a pulmonary fibrosis, or he has a pulmonary hemorrhage, or that diffuse pulmonary infiltrate, if he has a chronic disease from the start, if your patient has airway bronchospasm, you should give him a nebulizer and bronchodilator. You're putting a small endotracheal tube not suitable for the size of the patient, it will increase the resistive load, and we need a higher pressure support to maintain normal spontaneous breathing. Also, post extubation, if your patient has subglottic edema or increased airway secretion or has sputum retention, then get anyone all. Do not wean your patient until you are sure that your patient have adequate cuff, he's not having excessive sputum or excessive tracheal bronchial secretion. And also, you should use adequate size of the tube to avoid the subglottic edema. Also, cardiac load, if your patient has a cardiac dysfunction, like he is cardiac and initial cardiac disease, or who has increased cardiac workload, edema, myocardial dysfunction, or who has myocardial suppression related to sepsis or increased metabolic demand. If your patient has depressed central drive, like he has a CNS disease, or he has a mitochondrial disease, or he has a neurodegenerative disease, and he cannot maintain his normal respiratory drive, this patient cannot be weaned, and we need another method of weaning. Also, a peripheral dysfunction. لو عندنا primary cause of neuromuscular weakness, زي عيانين الجيمبري, زي عيانين بتوع spinal muscle atrophy, Verning Hoffman, بيبقى عندهم very difficult weaning. أو ثاني مال هو critical induced neuromuscular affection. Critical illness نفسه, critical illness by itself, it will cause a neuropathy and myopathy. It will cause weak respiratory function and may impair weaning. Okay. If you have neuropsychological issues, but it is more for adults or adolescents, not for children or small ages or babies. Metabolic, لو البيبي بتاعنا have hypophosphatemia, hypomagnesemia, hypokalemia, it will impair weaning. Steroids, لو have prolonged use of steroids, it can cause myopathy and neuropathy. Nutrition, زي ما اتفقنا, overweight, undernutrition, الاثنين بي impair weaning. لو عينا anemic, if a patient is anemic, it will impair weaning. You should treat all these reversible causes before starting weaning your patient. Okay. When to use non-invasive ventilation during weaning? When you put, يعني, انت تحط when to put your patient on CPAP after weaning him. When to put him non-invasively. Can you put him prophylactically after extubation if you're predicting that your patient will have a prolonged or a difficult weaning. They mean like a patient can intubate it for a very long period. So you can anticipating you will have a subglottic edema and airway edema, and you need to give him a pressure to overcome this obstruction. Or the patient develop acute respiratory failure after 48 hours of extubation, or alternative weaning method. لو العيان ما كانش استحمل initial weaning or initial spontaneous breathing trial. طيب, sorry for the pictures, but يعني مش عارف أقول إيه. After Dr. Martin's picture of non-invasive, this is very traumatizing for you, I know. This is weaning by non-invasive mask. This was in 2012. It was our first device in pediatric. You can notice that the mask is very large for the baby. بعدين, this is a non-invasive nasal CPAP, and this is a non-invasive endotracheal nasopharyngeal CPAP. Okay. This is our patient with successful weaning. You can see the depressed nasal bridge affected by the mask. Here you can see that side effect from the nasal CPAP because damage from the nasal septum and the skin laceration from the plaster, the tape. This patient, alhamdulillah, successfully weaned, although she had mucopolysaccharidosis and she was a cardiac patient, admitted 3 times in our PICU, and ventilated for a very long period and extubated immediately on non-invasive. And this is the device for non-invasive ventilation, was by nasal CPAP, and alhamdulillah, she discharged. طيب how to extubate, what are the extubation procedures, هنعمل ايه يعني لما نيجي نextubate our patient, ايه البروسيجرز اللي هناخدها. اول حاجه if your patient is on neuromuscular blockage you should stop it 4 hours before planned extubation, you should do suction from endotracheal tube, and if it is there, it is cuffed, you should deflate the cuff, and you should do suction from the oral cavity and nostrils. If you can suction from the rail before removing the endotracheal tube to avoid gagging أو حاجة عشان to avoid vomiting or aspiration. لازم you keep before removing the tube for extubation. You should put an oxygen source on the face of your patient using nasal cannula or face mask زي ما تحب. But you should put it before removing on the face of your patient before removing the tube. بعدين you should have beside you the kit for intubation again. You should have a working laryngoscope, correct size of endotracheal tube and ambu, and correct size mask and ambu for immediate intubation if your patient desaturated or developed bradycardia. Also, you should tell your nurse to give him to plan or to prepare nebulization with beta-stimulant adrenaline, open the buzinoidal hole while palmicort, inhale the corticosteroid to be given the patient after immediate extubation. Why? Because beta stimulant adrenaline will cause vasoconstriction. Palmicort also will cause decrease in inflammation, the upper airway edema. It will reduce upper airway edema and subglottic edema, which is a main cause of extubation failure in pediatrics. What is the dose of epinephrine in Egypt? We don't have racemic epinephrine. We have an epinephrine, and the dose would be 0.5 ml per kg. اللي هي 0.5 milligram, because the concentration is 1 milligram per ml. Other studies قالت إن هي لو child below 4 years you can use 2.5 ml in each nebulizer time. Well, above 5 years we can give him 5 ml, which is a huge dose. 5 ml adrenaline nebulization will make a systemic symptoms. A dose of racemic epinephrine which is not available in Egypt, 0.05 ml per kg, maximum 0.5 ml. Or dose of palmicort can give up to 2 milligram in one nebulizer session. Okay, what about intravenous steroids? We can give dexamethasone if you have extubation failure, or you can give it prophylactically if your patient is prolonged intubated. You can give a dose of dexamethasone, initial dose of 0.6 milligram per kg. Frequent doses can give 0.15 milligram per kg for 6 to 8 doses. So you can give it prophylactically, or you can give oral prednisone if your patient can tolerate oral intake. Okay, if your patient has volume overload or have negative fluid balance, you can give him intravenous furosemide to cause diuresis and maintain to prevent interstitial edema after removing the PEEP, or he has a primary myocardial dysfunction or secondary or mild from any secondary to the condition that needs mechanical ventilation. You should put your patient CPAP or non-invasive postoperative ventilation بعد intubation if you suspected لما زي ما قلنا قبل كده. طيب when to do blood gas, when to do blood gas around 20 to 30 minutes تقريبا نص ساعة بعد العين ما بيتشال. You don't need to do chest X-ray except لو عيانة clinically be desat أو if you have increased work of breathing. ونلاقي في chest X-ray we can find atelectasis or collapse due to viscous secretion or excessive secretion. And ideally, the ventilator should be available on standby mode near the patient for at least 24 hours after the extubation. وطبعاً ده كلها كل الناس. We should tell yourself and the parents and your juniors you must anticipate extubation failure. وما بقاش في disappointment. مع إن كلنا بيجي لنا disappointments if we extubate the patient and he failed and he needs the intubation again. Okay. What are the signs of extubation failure? زيها زي ال failure of spontaneous breathing trial. If your patient is tachypneic, tachycardic, or has clinical signs of respiratory muscle fatigue, if he desaturated or an ABG he has hypercapnia. The most common cause of extubation failure, obstruction of the airway after extubation. هذا most common cause we account up to 40% of cause of extubation failure. عشان كده you need to do to give your patient nebulization with adrenaline and palmicort. You should give your patient dexamethasone, and you should if you have a new unit available, CPAP or non-invasive ventilation, you should use it if your patient have an extubation failure or signs of airway edema. Okay, when to do tracheostomy for your patients? احنا عكس الادلت تماما. We are in the, not like the adults. In adults, they do tracheostomy if the patient has will be prolonged ventilated above 21 days. In our unit, we cannot do in pediatrics على العموم كلهم. We don't do tracheostomy after 21 days. We have few patients periods up to 3 months ventilated, and we can successfully extubate them without the need of tracheostomy. Because tracheostomy يعني needs specific maneuvers and specific care for the patient, and the results may carry higher hazards for the patients. Well, complications ساعتها كتيرة. It had multiple complications in our patients. وبرضو بيبقى عندها post يعني the need يعني in adults you can successfully remove the tracheostomy, but in pediatrics the patient may develop post tracheal
fundus.
يا دكتور سامعك
عدينا الوقت بكتير, نحاول نخلص.
حاضر اوكي نخلص نخلص
كويس في الحبه اللي فاضيه.
بس اوكي التراكيسمي ده 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 عينه عندنا. This is a patient in our unit. بص انكفالات سيكولي والتراكيسمي الادفانتج بتاعتها طبعا هي ايزير اير واي مانجمنت امبروف الكومفورت, بس هي الكومبليكيشن بتاعتها اكتر لكن هامرج والاوبستراكشن والديسبيسمنت. وده اخر حاجه, ده الجوريزم بيقول لنا هاو تو يعني ايه how to wean your patient. If your patient mechanical ventilation, you should do sedation titration with daily assessment if your patient readiness to wean. If you, and you should do spontaneous breathing trial. If your patient is ready for extubation, you should extubate him. Either يعني it will be extubated non-invasively or non or or an oxygen with no need of non-invasive. If he failed extubation, you would re-intubate him again, or you can try non-invasive first before re-intubation. And again, you should assess why your patient re-intubated by if pathology, Z was sedation, and your muscular affection, and you should treat each one of these pathologies. Thank you. Okay, doctor. خلاص يا دكتور أنا خلصت.
شكرا يا سامس. تفضل يا دكتور طار. طيب أنا صوتي مسموع كده؟ صوتي مسموع كده؟ صوتي مسموع. طيب أستاذ دكتور طارق عبد الجواد افتح المايك.
أيوه
اتفضل يا دكتور طارق.
صوتي مسموع كده يا حنان؟
أيوه اتفضل حضرتك.
ما بقولك أنا سعيد جدا بمحاضرات اليوم, أرجو أن تكون أمتعنا الحاضرين وأن استفادوا منها. المحاضرات كانت لحد بعيد على قد المسؤولية, ودايماً وأبداً دكتور أحمد واز قدم محاضراته الجميلة الممتعة عن الميكانيكال فنتليشن, كان فيها معلومات عن البيزك والأدفانسد مود أوف فنتليشن, وإحنا استمتعنا بها جداً. وأعتقد أي واحد بيبتدي الميكانيكال فنتليشن هيستفيد إلى حد بعيد من محاضرة الدكتور أحمد ريس. دكتور حنان دايما خارج نطاق المنافسة, محاضراتها دائما جميلة وممتعة وسهل البسيط اللي بتقولك المعلومة بأسهل طريقة وطريقة illuminating وواضحة, وبتقدم معلومات دايما على مستوى عالي جدا حقيقة دكتور حنان، أنا استمتعت جدا 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 بمحاضرتك، قد إيه كانت بسيطة وقد إيه كانت of great value. بروفيسور دكتور مارتي أكيد طبعا هي enjoy very much his illuminating lectures. He was very 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 presentable and his lecture was more than excellent. Thank you very much for his nice and beautiful lectures and comprehensive lecture. دكتورة سندس منتي المفضلة، هي عارفة محبتي ليها، محاضرتها طبعا جميلة جدا وفيها معلومات جديدة عن الكوفيد 19، حقيقة أنا استمتعنا جدا 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 بيها. الأسئلة هنلاقيها فين؟ أنا صوتي واضح يا حنان؟
جدا يا دكتور طارق، questions and answers Q and A تحت حضرتك،
فينا
المشكلة؟ نحاول نجاوب للشباب على الأسئلة تحت عند الشات، في
شات وكيو اند اي.
كيو اند اي مفتاحها.
انا شايف ثلاث اسئله.
طيب كويس.
How many times per day trial of spontaneous breathing trial؟ ده سؤال طبعا للدكتوره ساندس. احنا كم مره ممكن نعمل spontaneous breathing trial؟ دكتوره ساندس؟
معلش يا دكتور كنت بعمل انميوت بس. والله يا دكتور واحنا عندنا يعني هو المكتوب في كلهم هو starting from 30 minutes to 120 minutes if your patient can tolerate the pressure support ventilation you can proceed for weaning. لكن احنا بنعملها مثلا في البراكتس بتاعنا، احنا بنحط العيان على spontaneous mode، ولو هو لو عيان tolerating بنسيبه عليه، بنسيبه على spontaneous mode وبعد كده بن prepare for weaning. لكن لو العيان he cannot tolerate spontaneous mode انا بقلبه تاني على الماندتوري او الماندتوري بتاعه اللي هو كان عليه، وبنتراي تاني بعد ساعتين او بعد ثلاثة، او بنشوف الكوز اللي عامل فيلير في spontaneous breathing trial وبعد كده بعمل له ريفرسل كده ابتدي اوين تاني. لو العيان مثلا عنده كرونيك إلنس بنحاول احنا مثلا نحطه ساعتين وساعة زي ما حضراتكم علمتوا لنا كلنا، حضرتك عارف نحط عينة ممكن نبتدي الاول بساعتين ونص ساعة وبعد كده كان توليريت ساعتين مانداتوري وساعة بريشر سبورت. لو عين توليريتنج نعكس بقى يبقى ساعة ريت وساعتين بريشر سبورت انتل هي ايه ان هو بيستحمل هو على بريشر سبورت فنتيليشن على طول. لكن مش مكتوب في الجايد لاينز انت تستعملها كل قد ايه، لو معمول انت لو هي حصل هي لو عيان successfully you can successful breathing spontaneous breathing trial you should go for extubation، لو failed you should reverse تاني ايه الكوزس اللي عملت فيه كده وتعملها treatment وتحاول تاني، بس مش مكتوب. طبعا دورت عليه مش لقيتها.
ده حقيقه السؤال ده موجه ليك من بروفيسور دكتور طارق عطيه
طبعا
استاذنا العزيز واستاذنا الفاضل. خالص التحيه للدكتور طارق، شرفتنا ومحمد الزهر محاضرتك الجميله. دكتوره هبه ابراهيم تسال اعتقد الدكتور احمد رزق، What's the difference between pressure spontaneous ventilation and SIMV mode؟ دكتور احمد، دكتور احمد،
دكتور احمد، اسئله الدكتور مارتي لغايه ما الدكتور احمد يجي.
ما فيش حاجه مواجهه دكتور مارتي، لك انا ممكن اساله. بروفيسور دكتور مارتي، you recommend in management of ARDS to give lung recruitment maneuver. To our experience, the lung recruitment maneuver, it will improve the hemodynamics just for 3 to 4 hours. I cannot depend it completely. For a patient with Duchenne myopathy and marked weakness for respiratory muscle, to depend completely on recruitment maneuver. I think it can be, we can use it just for short times in medical emergency, but soon return again to high PEEP. And physiotherapy, I think, will be much better to give the best result than to depend completely on lung recruitment. I don't know what is your opinion. You depend on lung recruitment for a long time or just once and then keep your patient on high beep and physiotherapy?
So in my opinion, what is relevant regarding the recruitment maneuvers is that we should remember that they can be harmful and they can generate complications. So I recommend a cautious use. So just for a selected patients, and not to do every 8 hours. So just if you need in one point just to open the lung and to improve the oxygenation of that patient is the way I recommend to use it. During the COVID outbreak, some of my colleagues get a little bit crazy using recruitment maneuvers because they were very effective because the lung was really recruitable. But if the Pafu ratio is not below 150, there is no point. So it means only for very hypoxemic patients makes sense to use this maneuver. So just that we have a low level of evidence. So we don't have a randomized controlled trial saying that we are reducing the time of mechanical ventilation on ARDS, or that we are reducing mortality on ARDS. So I think that it's a tool that you should have in mind. And for those patients that are not ARDS, like the case I was showing you, perhaps a small and short one-time recruitment maneuver can help to improve the lung and shorten the time of the ventilator. It's just an idea or a suggestion. No, it should be a routine. I'm not recommending a routine use of a recruitment maneuver.
Thank you very much. The second question directed to Professor Dr. Hanan, and I know you answer. When must I ventilate asthmatic patient? Can I answer?
You can
don't ventilate.
Adopt the absolute indication. 1 year arrest, severe hypoxia, change in the mental state, العيان ابتدى يبقى confused. في relative indication, في absolute indication. I don't like to ventilate the asthmatic patient. However, in non-invasive ventilation حلت جزء كبير من المشكلة دي. عيانين كتير بيرسبوند عن non-invasive ventilation. ممكن نحطهم earlier طبعا كتير عن الانفيزيف فنتيليشن وممكن يستفيدوا من الانفيزيف فنتيليشن مع العلاج بقيه العلاج بتاع الازمه.
I completely agree with you, Professor Dr. Hanan. تعرف ان احنا نفس المدرسه. انت عارفين طبعا احنا لما فنت العيان اسماتيك بنزود المورتاليتي ريت. مفيش داعي خاص ان احنا فنت العيان. ممكن نعتمد على السباب، ممكن نعتمد على الهايفلونيت الكانيولا، ممكن نعتمد على جوسيديشن وبونك دايليتو، لكن فنتليشن عيان مع هاي ريسك بنزود انتراثيراسك بريشر، بنزود البريشر على اللنج، بندخل عندها بالمونه اديما اكتر، ما لهاش اي معنى. ثانك يو دكتور حنان، انا متفق معاك تماما في هذه المعلومه. دكتور ساندس ممكن تجاوب، لكن دكتور احمد انا عارف انت هتجاوب بيها كويس. الفرق من البريشر سبونتينيوس فنتيليشن والاس ام في.
دكتور ثانية. اي دكتور؟ هو دكتور احمد مشي؟ اوكي.
مش لاقي
احمد. دكتور احمد موجود.
طب ما يجاوب احمد، انا سالته. What's the difference between the pressure spontaneous ventilation and
SIMV؟ دكتور احمد لازم موجود اهو. دكتور احمد لازم موجود.
يا ريت يجاوبنا عليه السؤال ده. الفرق بين البريشر سبونتينيوس فنتيليشن والاس ام في.
اوكي. اوكي يا دكتور، انا ممكن اقول بس قبل ما دكتور احمد يرد. في السبونتيني في الاس ام في، في الاس ام في احنا هنا ده سينكرونايز انترميتنت مانداتوري فنتيليشن. هنا احنا بنظبط ميكانيكال ريت للعيان وهو بياخده. انت ظابط ريسبيرتوري ريت 30، هياخد العيان 30 ريسبيرتوري ريت ان بتوين كل يعني هو بياخد 30 نفس، الفنت بيديله 30 ريسبيرتوري ريت. الفنت بيالاو البيشنت هو ياخد كل سبونتينيوس باث اللي هو عاوزها، اللي هو الاس ام في بريشر سبورت بيسبورت ايه، لو هي معاه بريشر سبورت مود بيسبورت كمان اتش باث اللي العيان بياخده. فكده العيان ممكن ياخد تو تايبس اوف باث، ممكن هياخد مانداتوري باث اللي انا ظبطاهم، وهياخد لو هو حب ياخد سبونتينيوس هي ويل الاو ان هو ياخد سبونتينيوس باث، وكمان هي ممكن يديله بريشر سبورت فيهم. فالاس ام في بيبقى فيه مانداتوري باثز انت ظابطها وهو والعيان بياخدها. في البريشر سبورت مود هنا ده الفنت مش بيدي اي حاجة خالص except the beep and the pressure support، والعيان بياخد respiratory rate اللي هو بتاعه spontaneous breath بتاعته بس، مفيش اي backup، مفيش اي mandatory breath اللي انت بيديها. فالعيان هو اللي بيتريجر، العيان هو اللي بيأند السايكل بتاعته، عيان هو بيحدد الريسبيراتوري ريت. لو انا ظابطه باك اب، لو مثلا عيان بقى ابنك، الفنت بيبقى على باك اب مود اللي هو بيبقى اس ام في او اي سي بقى حسب ما انا ايه ظابطه المود الباك اب مود بتاعه. ففرق الاس ام في على البريشر سبورت مود ان الاس ام في في ريت انا بظبطه، في مانداتوري ريت بياخده ده المينيمم، لكن في pressure support mode respiratory rate ده بتاع العيان لوحده. في الـ SMV أنا بصبط respiratory rate و inspiratory time، هنا أنا بس بصبط بيب و pressure support في pressure support mode. SIMV ده mode of ventilation، ده ممكن initiate بيه للventilation، لكن pressure support mode ده mode of weaning. وفي ناس كتيرة بتستخدمه، يعني دكتور اسمه ايه بيتر بتاعنا بتاع اللي هو بتاع الـ ARDS والكاتب كل consensus، يعني هو بيستخدم، أو اللي أنا بستخدم two modes of ventilation بس، بيستخدم high frequency and pressure support mode، مش بيعترف أصلا بـ SIMV. فـ pressure support ده يعتبر mode of weaning، أو لو العيان كان يعني ممكن ياخد نفس الواحد حط عليه، فلا هو يعني ده supported، وده يعني ده فنت بيديله أنفاس، وده لا العيان هو اللي بياخد نفسه مع الفنتليتر.
Thank you دكتور سون سام، أنا كنت متأكد حضرتك
بس دكتور أعتقد دكتور أحمد أفيلبل، صح دكتور أحمد رزق أفيلبل، هو أحسن مني 100 مرة طبعا.
يمنا أن السؤال يتجاوب يعني.
لا هو دكتور أحمد أحسن مني 100 مرة يا دكتور، حضرتك عارفة
هو موجود أحمد؟
أوه أفيلبل. أوه بس
النت كان معلق عندي ولاش.
ماشي يا أحمد، السؤال موجه عن الفرق بين البريشر سبورت والاس ام في.
اما هي خاصه سندس جاوبت، انا مش هضيف حاجه، سندس جاوبت وزياده يعني.
اه طبعا هي نفس المدرسه يعني، هي تلمستك مش انت المعلمها؟
لمستك كبير، كلنا يا بيت لمستك كبير كلنا.
انا شرف كبير ان احنا نشتغل مع بعض، وان احنا حقيقه انت دايما بترفع راسي وراسنا جميعا. احنا سعداء جدا جدا بوجودكم معنا، وان احنا في نفس المدرسة مع بعض، حقيقة انتوا تشرفوا اي حد، وانتوا شايلين الرعاية، وانتوا اللي واخدين بالكم منها دلوقتي في غيابنا، وانا عارف ان انتوا بتقدموا شغل ما حصلش يعني، وانا شفت الشغل النهاردة والمحاضرات ممتعة جدا يعني، حاجة جميلة جميلة.
بعد اذنك يا دكتور طارق، ممكن اقول سؤالين متوجهين لدكتور مارتي؟
ياريت.
في حد من participants asking Professor Marty about proning, the prone position and the experience in prone position in pediatrics. Dr. Marty, is he available? Not
Dr.
anymore.
Dr. Marty.
Not anymore.
ما جاوب عليها يا دكتور حنان.
We need to know his own experience, مش our own experience. Our own experience in prone positioning في الـ severe ARDS, it works الحقيقة. وفي كلام كتير جدا على الـ prone positioning في الـ ARDS. دلوقتي كمان أكتر مع الـ era بتاع الـ COVID-19. Even الـ prone positioning recommended للعيانين invasive ventilation، بيحطوهم كمان دلوقتي prone positioning. بيحسن الـ VQ matching، ولكن لما نحط عيان على prone positioning، لو هو improving هنعمل الـ prone positioning ده frequently over the day، لكن لو العيان not improving على الـ prone positioning، يعني مع تمريضنا اللي ممكن يعمل dislodgement للتيوبس، ما يفضل ما نعملوش. This is our own experience.
هو الـ prone ventilation ما فيش مناقشة ان هو بيحسن الـ hemodynamics بتاعت العيان، وبيحسن الاكسجينيشن، لكن جميع الدراسات اثبتت رغم كده انه ما بيقللش المورتاليتي ريت، يعني بيحسن الهيمودينامكس وحسن الاكسجينيشن، لكن ما فيش فرق قوي في المورتاليتي ريت بين العيان حط على البون والعيان ما اتحطش على البون. انما وان اوف مانوفرز الجيده جدا عشان نعمل اوبن لانج مانوفرز، ونفتح اللانج الفيولاي، ونعمل لها بروبر ساكشن، نعملها proper drainage، وفي حاجة زي الكوفيد اللي فيها secretion كتير أعتقد إن هي of great value. طبعاً لولاتي هنحضروا لنا أكتر استخدموا الكورون وما استخدموش في حالات الكوفيد، وهل الأوتكام بتاعه أحسن ولا مش أحسن. لكن أتفق معاك يا دكتور حنان إن الكورون of value، لكن مش هو الحل المثالي الوحيد فيها، ممكن يكون adjuvant ل other line of treatment.
طيب في حد بيسألني أنا بقى يا دكتور طارق سؤال عن البيب في الأزمة، ده سؤال صعب جداً.
سؤال صعب جداً انتوا
احنا جداً، يعني ده الخناق، عايز أقول للدكتور محمد عادل إن ده الخناقة الكبيرة. الأدلس بيأدوبت فكرة إنهم يحطوا بيب قليل، إحنا بنحط الريجولار بيب بتاعنا، ونقيس الأوتو بيب بتاع العيان، ونحط الراوند الرقم الأوتو بيب، يعني العيان عنده الأوتو بيب بتاعه 5 بنحط على 6 بنحط على 7، وده بيختلف من عيان للتاني. but we have to add beep. هاي اور لو يختلف بالديجري وهايبرفين انفليشن من عيان للتاني والايرتراب من العيان للتاني. واحسن ديزيز نستفيد منه من اللوبس والجرافيكس هو الازمه، لان في احنا فعلا بنبقى محتاجين مساعده في العيانين دول ومحتاجين حد يقول لنا نعمل ايه فيهم، الماشين تساعدنا شويه، لكن مفيش رقم محدد للازمه علشان احط عليها العيان على بيت.
هو سؤال جميل فعلا ومفيد جدا، واعتقد اجابه حضرتك يعني ما فيش حاجه اكتر من كده ممكن حد يجاوب عليها اكتر من كده. في حد اسئله تانية دكتور حنان؟
انا مش شايفه الحاجات بقى. الدكتور مارتي، دكتور مارتي is not available anymore. ممكن نساله الصحابي الاسئله دي، هنقول لهم ان احنا مش هننسى الاسئله. بكره ان شاء الله دكتور مارتي هيتكلم عن الميكانيكال فنتليشن في الكوفيد، هنحط الاسئله دي قدامه. اول اسئله ان شاء الله دكتور مارتي يجاوب عليها بكره باذن الله. ان شاء الله
ان شاء الله. كده احنا نهايه اليوم الاول لمؤتمر وحده الرعايه المركزه. نرجو ان نكون اسعدناكم، ونحن في انتظاركم بكره في يوم الكوفيد 19. هيتكلم فيه اساتذه على اكبر قدر من الاهميه، كلهم هيتكلموا هيغطوا الكوفيد 19 من كل الاسبكت.